गुड मॉर्निंग बैच 22। टुडेज टॉपिक फॉर लेक्चर इज पेरियोडोंटल सर्जरी, म्यूकोजल सर्जरी, वेरियस प्रोसीजर्स। योर लर्निंग आउटकम्स फॉर टुडेज लेक्चर आर डिफाइन म्यूकोजिंजाइवल इन पेरियोप्लास्टिक सर्जरी, आउटलाइन ऑल द पेरियोप्लास्टिक प्रोसीजर्स, क्लासीफाई रिसेशन, डिस्कस द वेरियस पेरियोप्लास्टिक प्रोसीजर्स फॉलोड इन पेरियोडोंटिक्स, यूज द बेसिक नॉलेज ऑफ पेरियोप्लास्टिक सर्जरीज while drafting treatment plan, explain the indications, outcomes and complications of perioplastic procedures. Starting with the definitions, the term mucogingival surgery was initially introduced in literature by Friedman in 1957 to describe surgical procedures for the correction of relationships between the gingiva and the oral mucous membrane, with special reference to three problem areas. First one is attached gingiva, second shallow vestibule, third frenum interfering with the margin gingiva. Second term which is used is periodontal plastic surgery, which is defined as the surgical procedures performed to correct or eliminate anatomic, developmental or traumatic deformities of the gingiva or alveolar mucosa. World Workshop in Clinical Periodontics renamed mucogingival surgery as periodontal plastic surgery, a term which was originally proposed by Miller, and broadened it to include the following areas: periodontal prosthetic corrections, crown lengthening, ridge augmentation, aesthetic surgical corrections, coverage of the denuded root surface, reconstruction of papilla, aesthetic surgical corrections around implants, and surgical exposure of unerupted teeth for orthodontics. This is a classification system for periodontal surgery. So basically, periodontal surgery can be classified broadly in three types, which is first one is to treat periodontal disease, second one is to treat periodontal plastic surgeries, and third one is for the pre-prosthetic surgeries. So periodontal plastic surgeries can be again classified, which are done to treat the aesthetic concerns or treat the anatomic defects. The periodontal plastic surgery techniques included in the traditional definition of mucogingival surgery are widening of attached gingiva, deepening of shallow vestibules, resection of aberrant frena. Later on, other areas were also included, such as aesthetic surgical therapy for natural dentition and tissue engineering, then periodontal prosthetic surgery, aesthetic surgery around implants, and surgical exposure of teeth for orthodontic therapy. There are various opinions which has been expressed about the concern about the what should be the adequate or sufficient dimension of gingiva. So some of the authors have said that even 1 mm of gingiva may be sufficient, as stated by Bowers and all. Then one group of the authors, which was led by Kahn, they suggested that the apico-coronal height of keratinized tissue should exceed 3 mm or more. But when we compared all the literature reviews and the surgical therapies which we had, a third category of authors also proposed one idea, and which is used mostly. It states that the adequate amount of gingiva is any dimension that is compatible with the gingival health and prevents retraction of gingival margin during movements of the alveolar mucosa. So the five objectives of periodontal plastic surgery are problems associated with attached gingiva, problems associated with shallow vestibules, problems associated with aberrant frenum, aesthetic surgical therapy, and tissue engineering. The AAP definition of mucogingival therapy is non-surgical and surgical correction of the defects in morphology, position, and or amount of soft tissue underlying bone. So as we have discussed that The adequate width of gingiva is that width of gingiva which is compatible with the gingival health and prevent retraction of gingival margin during movements of alveolar mucosa. The prevailing concept was thus that a narrow zone of gingiva was insufficient, because to protect the periodontium from injury caused by friction forces encountered during mastication, to dissipate the pull on the gingival margin created by the muscles of adjacent alveolar mucosa, facilitated subgingival plaque formation because of improper pocket closure resulting from the movability of the margin tissue, and it favors attachment loss, Soft tissue recession in combination with shallow vestibular fornix might favor the accumulation of food particles during mastication and impede proper oral hygiene measures. So if we see in this clinical photograph, this tooth, if you see on the buccal aspect, it has narrow width of gingiva and it shows pronounced signs of inflammation when it is compared with the adjacent teeth. If we compare this tooth with this tooth or this tooth, the inflammation is more severe because of the anyone can guess in their mind, because the width of attached gingiva is less. Now if you compare this, can anyone guess what we are trying to show in these photographs? So in this, two teeth in a dog are shown with a varying dimension of margin gingiva. In this, the photograph 1A, this one, the buccal tooth with the wide zone of attached gingiva is there, and in this there is narrow band of gingiva. If you see here, this is wide zone, this is narrow zone. So for the experiment sake, these areas were left for the plaque accumulation, and postoperatively after 4 weeks, what was found? That the clinical sign of inflammations were more pronounced in the site where the width of gingiva was narrow. See here, if you compare here where the width of attached gingiva was more, the signs of inflammations are also less. Can anyone guess what we are trying to show here? In this, we are trying to show the recession which is associated with the localized plaque induced inflammatory lesion, because here the patient was unable to maintain good oral hygiene because shallow vestibule. So if shallow vestibule was there, patient was unable to place his bristles completely or with the proper angulation, which is of 45 degree. So slowly plaque got accumulated over here and the inflammation took place. Then comes the tissue barrier concept. A dense collagenous band of connective tissue retards or obstructs the spread of inflammation better than does loose fiber arrangement of alveolar mucosa. So in this flowchart, this flowchart can be used when to do the mucogenital surgery and when mucogenital surgery is not indicated. So if you see that patient is having lack of attached gingiva, and if there is progressive gingival recession and inflammation after initial therapy, the mucogenital surgery is indicated. But if there is no progressive gingival recession after initial therapy but still aesthetic considerations are there, you can do mucogenital surgery. But if there is no progressive gingival recession or inflammation after initial therapy and there is no aesthetic consideration, mucogingival surgeries are not indicated. There are various techniques for the increasing width of attached gingiva, so we will discuss them one by one. Starting with the gingival augmentation apical to the area of recession, so we can use a graft which can be either pedicled or fumicosal. In this type of surgeries, no attempt is made to treat denuded areas, and it increases the width of attached gingiva also. Speaking of gingival augmentation coronal to area of recession, a graft which is pedicled or free or mucosal can be used, and it is done to cover the denuded roots. It increases width of attached gingiva and it improves aesthetics also. So before going for the various techniques, does anyone remember the Miller's classification of gingival recession? I hope everyone remembers the Miller classification of gingival recession. We will just have a review of that. So Miller classified recession defects taking into consideration the anticipated root coverage that is possible to obtain with the use of free gingival graft. So class 1 is margin tissue recession not extending to the mucogingival junction and there is no loss of interdental bone or soft tissue. Class 2 is margin tissue recession which is extending to or beyond the mucogingival junction and there is no loss of interdental bone or soft tissue. Class 3 is marginal tissue recession extending to or beyond the gingival junction, and there is loss of interdental bone, soft tissue or malpositioning of the tooth. Class 4 is marginal tissue recession extending to or beyond the mucosal junction. There is severe loss of interdental bone and soft tissue, and there is severe malposition of the tooth. Cairo et al. In 2011 suggested one more simple classification of buccal recession, which has predicted the final root coverage outcome, and it is based on clinical assessment of interproximal attachment levels as RT1, RT2 and RT3. This classification is given in the new article, new classification article, which has been shared already. So recession type 1, which is called as RT1, is buccal tissue recession with no loss of interproximal attachment. Recession type 2, which is RT2, is buccal tissue recession associated with loss of interproximal attachment less than or equal to buccal attachment loss. Recession type 3, buccal tissue recession associated with loss of interproximal attachment greater than the buccal attachment loss. So before selection of surgical procedures, for each individual case, several factors has to be taken into consideration when selecting the surgical procedures. For achieving root coverage, for example, jaw, tooth position, recession depth and width, and tissue thickness and quality, apical and lateral to the recession, aesthetic demands and compliance. From an aesthetic point of view, the tissue coverage of the exposed root surfaces should be in harmony with the adjacent tissues, and hence a pedicle graft would be preferred. There are various factors which influence the degree of root coverage. First factor which has to be discussed is patient-related factors. As with other surgical periodontal procedures, poor oral hygiene will negatively influence the success of root coverage procedures. Further, predominant causative factors in development of gingival recession is tooth brushing trauma, and hence this factor has to be corrected to secure an optimal outcome in terms of root coverage. Second factor is site-related factors. Among site-specific factors, the level of interdental periodontal support may be of greatest significance for the outcome of root coverage procedures. From a biological point of view, if we compare middle class 1 and class 2, the root coverage is achievable 100%, but for class 3 and class 4, there will be partial root coverage. Then comes the technique-related factors. Several technique-related factors may influence the treatment outcome of a pedicle graft procedure. For complete root coverage, the critical threshold thickness was found to be 1 mm. However, whether a full or split thickness pedicle graft is used for root coverage may not influence the treatment outcome. Starting with the classical technique. So in classical techniques, 4 steps are there. First step is preparation of the recipient graft. Second step is obtain a graft from donor site. Third step is transfer and immobilization of the graft. And the fourth is protection of the donor site. So in these two photographs, you can see the pre and post operative photographs. This is pre, this is post. And you can see this area has been treated. You can compare this area with this post operative area. You can clearly see the changes. This is preoperative area. This is the outline of incisions which we have decided after seeing the patient related factors, site related factors and all the other factors, and taking consideration of the needs of the patient and the treatment outcome, like this. So this is how incision will be placed. Here we are giving incision following the same incision line which we have decided prior to starting the therapy. This is how it will look after the incision has been given. You can see here. Here we have reflected the flap completely after giving the incision. So after this, a thin aluminum foil which is sterilized is placed over here, which will be used as a template, and this template will be transferred on the palate, and incision will be given around this aluminum foil. This is how palate will look like after the incision has been given. Following that, the डोनर ग्राफ्ट विल बी टेकन विद द हेल्प ऑफ विच इज दिस नाइफ, दिस इज क्रिकलैंड नाइफ राइट, बिकॉज वी आर गोइंग फॉर पार्शियल थिकनेस लैब, सो वी आर यूजिंग क्रिकलैंड नाइफ ओवर हेयर एंड इट इज रिमूव कंप्लीटली लाइक दिस. दिस इज हाउ द डोनर साइट विल लुक लाइक. दिस इज द प्री ऑपरेटिव प्रोसीजर्स विच वी हैव डन. वी आर गोइंग टू गिव पेशेंट एंड हॉल इज अप्लायंस विद रेस्ट इन द एरिया फ्रॉम वेयर द डोनर साइट, फ्रॉम वेयर द डोनर, फ्रॉम वेयर द ग्राफ्ट विल बी टेकन विद द हेल्प ऑफ हॉल इज अप्लायंस. देर विल बी पेशेंट कंफर्ट विल इंक्रीज, दैट्स वाई वी गिव पेशेंट हॉल इज अप्लायंस. दिस इज हाउ द डोनर साइट इज प्रोटेक्टेड. Now the graft is transferred to the recipient bed and it is sutured over here. Now suturing is completed. This is how the healing, how it starts. In first few days or first few days, there will be slight degeneration and the graft may shrink also, but no need to worry. As the healing takes place, revascularization occurs, the graft will blend completely with the adjacent area. You can see it here. So this is how it will look postoperatively. Healing is completed. It will take some more time and it will completely blend with the adjacent healthy area. Then there are varying techniques such as accordion technique, strip technique and combination technique. Accordion technique, where the graft will be extended by given alternate incisions on opposite sides. So here you can see this area which has to be treated. This is the graft which is taken from the palate and we have given incisions on the opposite sides alternatively, which will cause the increase in the width of the graft. Can you imagine this? Then now this, when we are trying to pull the graft, see here incisions are given, so now we can pull the graft, so the size of the graft will be more. So then this graft will be transferred on the recipient set side and this is how it will look after the healing. Then comes healing of the graft. Success of the graft depends on the survival of connective tissue. Connective tissue withstands and determines the fate of the graft. Initially, graft survival is by diffusion of fluid from host bed, adjacent gingiva and alveolar mucosa. The fluid is transferred from host vessel. It provides nutrition and hydration, which is essential. So starting with the healing. So first day, connective tissue becomes edematous and disorganized. There will be degeneration. There will be lysis of some of its element. There will be lowered edema and as healing progresses, new gradation tissue will form. This phase is called as initial phase. During the first day of healing, a thin layer of exudate will be present between the graft and recipient side. A thick layer of exudate or blood clot may hamper the plasmatic circulation and result in rejection of the graft. The epithelium of the free graft degenerates early in the initial healing phase and subsequently is desquamated. In placing a graft over session, part of recipient bed will be avascular root surface. Since the graft is dependent on the nature of its bed for diffusion of plasma and subsequent revascularization, the utilization of free grafts in the treatment of gingival session involves a greater risk of failures. The area of graft over the avascular root surface must receive nutrients from the connective tissue bed that surrounds the recession. Thus, the amount of tissue that can be maintained over the root surface is limited by the size of avascular area. So, second and third day, which is the revascularization phase or revascularization phase, capillaries from the recipient bed penetrate into graft to form a network of new capillaries and they anastomose with the pre-existing vessels. Central portion of the graft is lost to vascularize at 10 days. Thus, the circulation of blood is re-established in the pre-existing blood. At the same time, a fibrous union is established between the graft and the underlying connective tissue bed. The re-epithelialization of the graft occurs mainly by proliferation of epithelium from the adjacent tissues. If a free graft is placed over the denuded root surface, apical migration of epithelium along the tooth facing surface of the graft may take place at this stage of the healing. During 7 to 8 days, the graft is firmly adherent to the recipient bed. A thin layer of new epithelium is present with triatric pegs. Then comes the tissue maturation phase. So in tissue maturation phase, during this period, the number of blood vessels in the transplant is gradually reduced, and approximately by 14 days, the vascular system of graft appears normal. Also, the epithelium gradually matures and there is a formation of keratin layer during this stage of healing. The establishment and maintenance of a plasmatic circulation between the recipient bed and the graft during the initial phase of healing is critical in these kinds of therapies. Therefore, in order to ensure ideal conditions for healing, blood between the graft and the recipient site must be removed by exerting pressure against the graft following suturing. So if we see microscopically, healing of graft in the intermediate thickness graft will be done by 10 or 11th week. If the graft is thicker, then it will take place by 16 weeks. And the functional integration of graft occurs by 17 days. Graft eventually blends with the adjacent tissue and becomes pink, firm and healthy. Here, this is the micropictograph where you can see in these photographs, this is the after the immediate placement of the graft. So there are loss of blood vessels, and in this, when the healing starts, it starts to anastomose with the pre-existing vessels. Slowly the revascularization starts and the graft will get its vascularity, and this is how it will look like when the healing is completed. Slowly it will bend completely with the adjacent tissue. Then comes technique for removal of frenum. So everyone knows what is frenum. Anyone knows the definition of frenum? So the frenum is a fold of mucosal membrane enclosed with muscle fibers that attaches the lips, cheeks, gingiva and alveolar mucosa. Tension on the frenum may pull the margin gingiva away from the tooth, so plaque control is difficult. Gingival inflammation might be there. There might be pocket formation, and there might be mobility and migration. So depending on the extent of attachment of fibers, frenum has been classified by Plasek et al. In 1974 as mucosal, gingival, papillary and papillary penetrating. We all know that this classification is based upon the attachment. So if you see in the mucosal type of frenum, the attachment is on the mucosa. When we speak it as gingival, so the attachment is in gingiva. When we speak of papillary, the frenum is attached on the interdent papilla. You can see over here. And when it's papillary penetrating, it is penetrating the papilla and going on the other side of the mucosa, and this type of frenum causes midline diastema also. So the next term which we are going to discuss is frenectomy and frenotomy. So in frenectomy, complete removal of frenum including its underlying attachment to the bone is there, but in frenotomy only the incision of the frenum is there. The purpose of these both techniques is same. It is done to relocate the frenum or to create a zone of attached gingiva, and it also helps in better plaque control. If you see here, this is how the frenum is. This type of frenum is papillary penetrating. You can papillary or just starting of papillary penetrating. You can see here. So what we have to do is first this is called as the diamond technique. So we are going to hold the frenum with the help of artery forceps. After that, one incision will be given on the upper surface of artery forceps. One incision will be given below surface of the artery forceps, which both the incision will be joining at the tip of artery forceps, and the frenum will be removed. And we have to keep in mind, when the frenum is removed, we should also remove all of its attachment to the underlying bone. So here, frenum is removed completely, including its attachment to the underlying bone. After that, suturing will be done. And this is how it will look postoperatively when healing takes place. Can anyone guess which is this type of frenum? So all of who have thought this frenum as papillary or gingival, they both are correct, because this is just a photograph. We need to do the tension test to confirm it. So if you have said yes, it is papillary, that also states correct as of now. And if you said yes, it's gingival, it also stays correct. So this is how one more example of frenectomy is can be seen. Again, in this we are going to give incisions after effecting the frenum. Here we will be holding it so that we can see how the underlying attachments are there, and it will be completely removed. Then suturing will be done, and this is how it will look post-operatively after healing. Now comes the crown lengthening. So the crown lengthenings may be required to solve problems as inadequate amount of true structure for proper restorative therapy, or the subgingival location of fracture lines, or subgingival location of caries lesions. The techniques used to accomplish crown lengthening include an apically positioned flap, and it can be forced tooth eruption without fibrotomy, or it can be gingivectomy. The first thing to understand is that while doing crown lengthening, the integrity of biological width has to be maintained. So this is biological width, which is the total sum of junctional epithelium and the connective tissue attachment. Or flap possesses with possessory contouring. So in this, because the probing depth was less than 3 mm, we have done the flap procedures with accessory contouring. This is how it was preoperatively. After the flap has been reflected, we have reduced the bony. We have done the bone recontouring also. Suturing was done. This is how it will look after the healing, and this is how it looks after the placement of the prosthesis. This is also one of the example. Everyone has seen how they have started. Again, in this, because the grip depth was less than 3 mm, we have done modified between flap. You can see here an incision was given 1 to 2.5 to 1 mm from the gingival margin. After that, tissue collar was removed, followed by the accessory contouring. You can see here there is an increase in the dimension of the crown structure. After that, suturing has been done, and this is how it will look after the healing and the placement of prosthesis. Then comes ridge augmentation. The classification of ridge defects by Sabert is class 1, class 2, and class 3. Class 1 is where the buccolingual loss of tissue with normal ridge height in the apicocoron dimension is seen. Class 2 is apicocoron loss of tissue with normal ridge width in a buccolingual dimension. And there is class 3, which is combination where buccolingual and apicolingual coronal loss of tissue is there, resulting in loss of normal height and width. Here, this is interpositional graft procedures in conjunction with second stage only graft. So this is the preoperative view of the patient. This patient is having class 3 ridge defect where both there is loss in the height and the width of the ridge. So here we are trying to show the sequence of steps, and the treatment which we are going to do is the wedge procedure. So here you can see the wedge is there, which is a section of connective tissue with this epithelium, and it is removed from the palate and it is inserted between the elevated pouch like flap and the ridge. So here a pouch is prepared which has to receive the wedge type graft which has been taken from palate, and it is sutured back. So this is how it will look like after the healing. So after that, the second stage will be there. In second stage, the only graft was sutured into the position. The pontics were adjusted and brought into the light contact with the graft. There will be an inflammation around the graft for first 14 days, but it will heal eventually completely. Then after that, there will be gingivoplasty will be performed to deepen the pontic sites for ovate pontics here. And this is how it will look postoperatively. Then this is pouch procedure for ridge augmentation. Here you can see again there is deficiency in the ridge, so we have made a pouch over here. We have given incision, and this is how a pouch will look. In this pouch we are going to insert the graft which has been taken from the palate, and we will suture it. And this is how it will look postoperatively after healing takes place. So there is improvement in the ridge dimension. You can see preoperatively and postoperatively. Then comes buccal ridge enhancement at the time of implant exposure. So here you can see this is the buccal and occlusal view prior to implant exposure. Here the present concave contour and the desired final convex form is there. In this, implant is exposed with conservative occlusal surgery and buccal partial thickness pouch and connective tissue graft is inserted inside this pouch and it is sutured and stabilized. So this is how it will look after the healing. Then comes prevention of ridge collapse associated with tooth extraction. So according to Borghetti, the recommended method for prevention of bone ridge collapse after tooth extraction in the cases where fracture of the vestibular osseous plate is seen during the tooth extraction or due to the trauma, or where the resorption of vestibular osseous plate is seen, or where there is a presence of thin vestibular bone plate. So procedures were proposed for prevention of ridge collapse in conjunction with tooth extraction. It can be flap elevation with complete and soft tissue closure of the extension sites. It can be placement of connective tissue grafts over the extension sites, or it can be placement of bone grafts in the site, or we can use the barrier membranes also. So here they have shown a cross section of a tooth extracted site immediately after the extraction, and in this the site is filled with the grafting material, and you can see how the healing will take place after 3 to 6 months. There will be complete regeneration of the bone. So this is important when you are planning to expose the do the crown lengthening for excessive gingival display or where there is less gingival display. So in most patients, the lower edge of the upper lip, if there is gummy profile, then we can also do the gingivectomy, but that is not to be discussed here, that we will discuss in the other chapter. So a base for treatment decision should be done after careful analysis of the dentofacial structures and how they may affect aesthetics, and all those should be facial symmetry, intrapupillary line, smile line, it can be dental midline, gingival display, harmony of gingival margins, location of gingival margin, parental phenotype, tooth size and proportion of the tooth to the other extraoral or extraoral structures, and incisal plane, occlusion plane. Then comes surgical exposure of unerupted teeth. So here, this is unerupted tooth, which can be seen here. Everyone can see. So here we will be giving an incision around the tooth which is unerupted, and we will be removing this soft tissue covering which is fibrous and thick in nature. This is how it will look immediately after the removal of the thick covering of around the unerupted teeth, and this is how it will look after the healing. There is more example which has been done in the conjunction with the help for the ortho department. Here you can see tooth was completely unerupted. Here also the flap has been elevated to expose the impacted canine, followed by the trimming of flap and bracket is placed, and this after placement of bracket, the ortho forces will be used to move this impacted canine in the correct position, which is here. Then comes the part where we can use the movement of the tooth for the covering of the recession, as seen here. If you see here, if just imagine that this tooth is placed buccally, so there will be less covering of gingiva, less bone. So after, when we start the tooth movement in the lingual direction, there will be an increase in the bone height, there will be increase in the gingival height, and there will be the coronal migration of the soft tissue. The clinical implication of the results from various studies have shown that labial tooth movement should be preceded by careful examination of the dimension of the tissue covering the facial aspect of the teeth to be moved. As long as a tooth can be moved within the envelope of the error process, the risk of harmful side effects on the margin tissue is minimal. Also, irrespective of the dimension and quality of the soft tissue surrounding the tooth. If, however, the tooth movement is expected to result in the establishment of error bone dehiscence, the volume of covering soft tissue should be considered as a factor that may influence the development of soft tissue recession during as well as after the phase of active orthotherapy. Then comes the summary. So mucogenal therapy includes gingival augmentation to increase the width of attached gingiva. It also includes the augmentation of the adventitious ridge. Then vestibular deepening procedures, aberrant frenum, removal of aberrant frenum, prevention of ridge collapse associated with tooth extraction, and crown lengthening. And the selection criteria for surgical procedure should be there based from patient to patient, and it is regulated by the several factors that has to be taken in consideration when selecting a surgical procedures. For example, the factors can be jaw, tooth position, recession depth and width, and tissue thickness, and the quality of apical and lateral to the recession, or the aesthetic demands and compliance from the patient. From the aesthetic point of view, the soft tissue coverage of the exposed root surface should be in harmony with the adjacent tissue, hence a pedicle graft would be the preference. For maxillary teeth, the coronally advanced flap may be considered as the basic procedure to be used for single as well as multiple recession. If the quality of the mucosa apical to the recession is considered inadequate for root coverage, the procedure is combined with the placement of connective tissue graft. In the mandible, the placement of free connective tissue graft with envelope or a tunnel preparation is preferred because of a thin mucosa apical to the recession and often the presence of multiple frenula, and that is a condition not suitable for coronally advanced flap. In case of localized gingival recession, defects of moderate depth, a rotational flap may be used if cartilaginous mucosa of sufficient dimension are available lateral to the recession. Soft tissue recessions at the dental implants are commonly associated with thin mucosa, and hence the surgical approach to regain the soft tissue coverage of the implant unit has to involve a connective tissue graft, either in combined processes with the coronally advanced flap or in a two-stage procedures with placement of connective tissue graft with an envelope procedures followed by coronally advanced flap as a second procedures. Thank you. So if you have any doubt or any query, you can always reach back to us. Department of Pediatrics will try their best to remove all the queries you have. Stay safe, stay healthy.